It's always a bit surprising to me, the joy that comes with returning to these poems, which are always so much better than I remember them. Treasures, really, a very special quality and achievement. As poems, they speak for themselves, so I won't make much comment. In other words, I don't want to interfere with your experience of the poem in hearing them, though I will make a couple of remarks now and then that may be useful. Nothing much about the authors, but of course afterward I'd be happy for any questions about them as well, because a number of them I knew, and they stayed at our house, and I arranged for them to read, and some of them became quite good friends. These are modern poems, and rich resources of art that convey the experience of war, of resisting war, and of constructing peace. They are not, in other words, preachy. They're not rhetorical in the preachy sense. There are probably, as you know, more bad poems about peace than any other subjects. Most of them I can hardly even read. These are not that kind of poem. They come out of the whole experience of the person. They are works of art that show us the full implications of violence, but also different manifestations of peacemaking, and they also give us a language. There is language in these poems that is new. The poets have not failed us. They have been looking after the language, a language that is now dominated by dominance and by violence in our images, in the things that we say, and the whole construct of violence that controls and dominates so much of our culture. In 50 years of involvement in the peace movement, the first thing was when I participated in a protest at the movie theater in Durham, North Carolina in 1961. Some undergraduate students at Duke had helped to organize this really amazing demonstration involving a lot of African-American students from North Carolina College, where I later taught. And I was so unconscious, so unaware of what nonviolence is about. And these students were really, they had obviously been schooled in nonviolence. They told us what to do, when, and how to be most effective with the demonstration. At that time, African Americans were not allowed to sit on the first floor of the theater. They had to go to what they called the crow's nest, which I thought was very witty. But it was humiliating, of course. But this was a protest, and of course, they won. It's just a great thing to remember. In recent years, too, I think if you know the UN Decade for the Culture of Peace and Nonviolence for the Children of the World, this document passed by 189 nations in the General Assembly in 1999, that much of the language in that document, in that declaration, reflects this language that you're going to hear. In other words, the poets, the unacknowledged legislators of the world, as Shelley said, have made a difference. I'm going to begin with a poem that, it's kind of dumb to say, but I think it's probably the greatest poem that I'm going to read. At least I can never believe the poem. It's by Wilfred Owen, whom you may know, died guiding his troops across a canal in northern France 91 years ago, almost to this day. He died at 25 and left us with some of the great poems in English. This is called Elegy. He was British. So you can imagine him standing in the battlefield in northern France, his dead friend at his feet. Futility. Move him into the sun. Gently its touch awoke him once at home, whispering of fields unsown. Always it woke him, even in France, until this morning and this snow. If anything might rouse him now, the kind old sun will know. Think how it wakes the seeds, woke once the clays of a cold star. Our limbs, so dear achieved, our sides, full nerved, still warm, too hard to stir. Was it for this the clay grew tall? Oh, what made fatuous sunbeams toil to break earth's sleep at all? That was from the First World War. Here's one from the Second World War by Randall Jarrell. Some of you may know and some may not, or may be familiar with the kind of airplane he's talking about. This is a fellow who has been put down into a glass-encased turret, the ball turret, at the end of an airplane. And there he has a gun, a machine gun, and sophisticated gun. But he's totally vulnerable there, and many, many people were killed, of course. And he's been sitting there amid the black flak, that is, the guns that are shooting from below and also the guns coming from the enemy planes. And he speaks. Death of the ball turret gunner. From my mother's sleep, I fell into the state, and I hunched in its belly till my wet fur froze. 6 miles from earth, loosed from its dream of life, I woke to black flak and the nightmare fighters. When I died, they washed me out of the turret with a hose. Bruce Weigel was in the Vietnam War and really an extraordinary poet. He has a book called Song of Napalm, from which I've chosen this book called Elegy. As you know, the tradition of the elegy, often it's a poem about a young person who has died in his or her prime. That is, someone who showed great promise but did not live to fulfill it. This is obviously, he is in Vietnam. Elegy. In sunlight they marched into dog day, into no saint's day, and were cut down. They marched not knowing how the air would be sucked from their lungs, how their lungs would collapse, how the world would twist itself, would bend into the cruel angles. Into the black understanding they marched until the angels calling their names, until they rose one by one from the blood. The light blasted down on them, the bullets sliced through the razor grass, so there was not even time to speak. The words would not let themselves be spoken. Some of them died. Some of them were not allowed to. Denise Levertov is one of the great poets of the mid-20th century, and she was active in the peace movement. Her husband was arrested with Benjamin Spock in the burning of draft cards in Boston. And Denise really developed a means of conveying, I think, the shadows of war in a way that takes them to our heart. They're, of course, brilliant, but she was able to find a language to say things that really had not been said before. This is a poem, Life at War. It's a longer poem, and it's, I think, one of the great lyrics in the language. And she's reflecting on how war has changed us. And she says, the same war continues. She begins with a quote from Rilke during the First World War, and almost suggesting that the war has been going on ever since, and that that has had an effect upon our very lives, the very membranes of our bodies. life at war. The disasters numb within us, caught in the chest, rolling in the brain like pebbles. The feeling resembles lumps of raw dough weighing down a child's stomach on baking day. Or Rilke said it, "My heart, could I say of it, it overflows with bitterness." But no, as though its contents were simply balled into formless lumps. Thus do I carry it about. The same war continues. We have breathed the grits of it in all our lives. Our lungs are pocked with it, the mucous membranes of our dreams coated with it, the imagination filmed over with the gray filth of it. The knowledge that humankind, delicate man, whose flesh responds to a caress, whose eyes are flowers that perceive the stars, whose music excels the music of birds, whose laughter matches the laughter of dogs, whose understanding manifests designs fairer than the spider's most intricate web, still turns, without surprise, with mere regret, to the scheduled breaking open of breasts whose milk runs out over the entrails of still alive babies, transformation of witnessing eyes to pulp fragments, implosion of skinned penises into carcass gullies. We are the humans, men who can make, whose language imagines mercy, loving kindness. We have believed one another mirrored forms of a God we felt is good, who do these acts, who convince ourselves it is necessary. These acts are done to our own flesh. Burned human flesh is smelling in Vietnam as I write. Yes, this is the knowledge that jostles for space in our bodies, along with all we see, as long we all go on knowing of joy, of love. Our nerve filaments twitch with its presence day and night. Nothing we say has not the husky phlegm of it in the saying. Nothing we do has the quickness, the sureness, the deep intelligence living at peace would have. So those are poems from the battlefield in many ways. And I guess you could say they are anti-war poems, though they are much more than that. The next group of poems are rather different in the sense that they are, the voices in them are people struggling to balance what Denise talked about in the latter part, the joy and the love with the knowledge of war that jostles in our feelings and in our brains. It's a short poem which she wrote in the 1980s. Concurrence, that is, all this is all going on at the same time. Each day's terror, almost a form of boredom, madmen at the wheel and stepping on the gas and the brakes no good, and each day one, sometimes two morning glories, faultless, blue sometimes flecked with magenta, each lit from within with the first sunlight. I'm sure some of you know the poems of Mary Oliver. This is an early poem, and I every time I read it, I wonder, now how in the world did she ever write this poem? It's called "The Eskimos Have No Word for War." And it's about somebody from the lower 48 who go up to visit the Eskimos in Alaska. And she, of course, comes with all her baggage of, you know, being from the empire and is sitting with them, and you'll see their response. The Eskimos have no word for war. Trying to explain it to them leaves one feeling ridiculous and obscene. Their homes, like white bulls, sit on a prairie of ancient snowfalls, caught beyond thaw or the swift changes of night and day. They listen politely and stride away. With spears and sleds and barking dogs to hunt for food, the women wait, chewing on skins or singing songs, knowing that they have hours to spend, that the luck of the hunter is often late. Later, by fires and boiling bones in steaming kettles, they welcome me, far kin, pale brother, to share what they have in a hungry time, in a difficult land. While I talk on of the southern kingdoms, cannons, armies, shifting alliances, airplanes, power, they chew their bones and smile at one another. Oh my, William Stafford, who died in 1993, over 50 years a member of the Fellowship of Reconciliation, a CO during the Second World War, wrote a brilliant memoir about it called Down in My Heart, which I recommend. This is a very short poem, only 8 lines, a meditation. But again, I'm always surprised at how much it says. And it says that in regard that peace is something that has to be made, has to be built, and we're the ones who have to do it. Mediation. Animals full of light walk through the forest towards someone aiming a gun loaded with darkness. That's the world. God holding still, letting it happen again and again and again. Well, poems of resistance, of course, are quite wonderful too, and I wanted to read one of them. This is by Daniel Berrigan. It was written while he was in Danbury Federal Prison. It's called Skunk. He's in his prison cell, and he looks down in the yard, and here this animal is wandering in, just kind of making its way around. And he hails the skunk and challenges him to carry on the resistance. Skunk. The only fauna admitted to the widespread country zoo, every animal in his natural habitat, no visible bars, was an unloquacious, bumbling skunk. He crept in under the full moon like a moon thing, eyes dazed, moonstruck. Limped along unhandily as though on 5 feet or 3, footsore, looking for what? We wished he would breathe deep as an ancestor, metamorphose 10 times his size, piss high as a Versailles fountain, his remarkable mask perfume. We didn't want additional prisoners, even dumb ones. If they must come atavistic, mystical, then let them be spectaculars, troubleshooters. Oh, skunk, raised against law and order, your grandiose, geysering, stinking no. And at 89, he's going strong. Recently arrested for civil disobedience in New York. What a gift he has been, and what he has been through. I had a remarkable letter from him recently in which it was a letter actually from Thich Nhat Hanh, who had written to Daniel. They had befriended one another, and they published a book together, actually. And it was about suffering, and about bringing your sufferings to friends. It was extraordinarily moving. And Dan was saying that it meant so much to him when Thich Nhat Hanh told him of the dream because he had received this message at a time when he, a very low time for himself, and he must have had a number of them because he's been subjected to an awful lot, but triumphed. This is a poem from the Second World War by Carl Shapiro. It's called Conscientious Objector. And the speaker in the poem, I'm guessing, but I'm not so guessing because I know Shapiro's biography, but he was in the South Pacific. He was a soldier, and he refers to a person who is kissing the hot peach. In other words, he's a soldier who's been involved in invasions. But he's thinking not about himself, but about his friend back in the United States who's in prison as a CO. And he sees him there in the prison. He said, it's like a ship, like the ship or the boat on Mount Ararat, or like the Mayflower sailing out to new territories. It's an acknowledgement and really a praise of the CO from a combatant. The scene is the prison. The conscientious objector. The gates clanged and they walked you into jail, more tense than felons, but relieved to find the hostile world shut out, the flags that dripped from every mother's windowpane, obscene the bloodlust sweating from the public heart. The dog authorities slavering at your throat, a sense of quiet, of pulling down the blind, possessed you. Punishment, you felt, was clean. The decks, the catwalks, and the narrow light composed a ship. This was a mutinous crew, troubling the captains for plain decencies. A Mayflower, brim with pilgrims, headed out to establish new theocracies to west. A Noah's Ark coasting the topmost seas, 10 miles above the salamites and fish. These inmates loved the only living doves. Like all men hunted from the world, you made a good community, voyaging the storm to no safe Plymouth or green Ararat. Trouble or calm, the men with Bibles prayed. The gaunt politicals construed our fate, the opposite of all armies. You were best opposing uniformity and yourselves. Prison and personality were your fate. You suffered not so much physically, but knew maltreatment, hunger, ennui of the mind. Well might the soldier kissing the hot peach erupting in his face damn all your kind. Yet you who saved neither yourselves nor us are equally with those who shed the blood, the heroes of our cause. Your conscience is what we come back to in the armistice. Wonderful to read this poem and to have Randy Keeler sitting in the front row. I think of him all the time, his time in prison. Marvelous line, isn't it? The speaker says, you are equally with those who shed the blood, the heroes of our cause. Your conscience is what we come back to in the armistice. Well, now, poems about making peace. And the greatest one by Denise Levertov. I stole a line from this, with her permission, for my book, which is called An Energy Field More Intense Than War, The Nonviolent Tradition in American Literature. And this is new in the language. Peace, you'll hear this line, peace, a presence, an energy field more intense than war. Isn't that fantastic? That she found the words to say that. So now I don't know, it's an affirmation for me because I was so caught, I think, in the anti-war rhetoric. And to say, no, this is positive. This is making, constructing something. That's what we're about. We're not just protesting against. Right, Suzanne? We're making. Peace. And that's the title of her poem. I always imagine this as a film, really. I wish somebody would film it, because there are two voices in the poem. The first one is that of, I imagine, the poet or whoever, the speaker, on a stage with all kinds of lights around and a large audience like yourselves. And the speaker is standing there, and suddenly, out of the dark, somebody cries out, "The poets must give us imagination of peace." And she accepts the challenge. And then she responds, as you'll hear. Making peace. A voice from the dark cries out, "The poets must give us imagination of peace to oust the intense, familiar imagination of disaster. Peace, not only the absence of war." The response. "But peace, like a poem, is not there ahead of itself, can't be imagined before it is made, can't be known except in the words of its making. Grammar of justice, syntax of mutual aid. A feeling towards it, dimly sensing a rhythm, is all we have until we begin to utter its metaphors, learning them as we speak. A line of peace might appear if we restructured the sentence our lives are making, revoked its reaffirmation of profit and power, questioned our needs, allowed long pauses. A cadence of peace might balance its weight then on a different fulcrum. Peace, a presence, an energy field more intense than war, might pulse then stanza by stanza into the world, each act of living one of its words, each word a vibration of light, facets of a forming crystal." Poetry is concentrated. I know it asks a lot of us, you know, in hearing it. It's music and more music and more music. So I'm pausing in part just to allow the sound some space. But I must read another poem by Denise Levertov. She died in 1997, and she and Muriel Rukeyser, I will read her poem also at the end, went to Vietnam, and poems, several of their poems came from there, very powerful poems, like the ones that Daniel Berrigan wrote when he was there with Howard Zinn. But Denise also had this sense of awe, of joy about her, and which I think she conveys in this poem. The title is "About Political Action in Which Each Individual Acts from the Heart." When solitaries draw close, releasing each solitude into its blossoming, when we give to each other the roses of our communion, a culture of gardens, arbors among the lettuce, small terrains, when we taste in small victories sometimes the small, ephemeral, yet joyful harvest of our striving, great power flows from us, luminous, a promise, yes. Then great energy flows from solitude and great power from communion. I'm going to end with a poem by Muriel Rukeyser. It's called Simply Poem. She's thinking about She's thinking with us at this moment and living in the midst of continual war. She struggles with that, and then she moves through it toward an affirmation, as you'll hear. I hope you know this great woman who died in 1980. One of my favorite stories about her is she was president of PEN in New York. She'd had two strokes. She was not well at all. There was a poet by the name of Kim Chi-ha who was in prison in South Korea, and he was going to be executed. You know, the U.S., we cooperated with the South Koreans, and the massacres in the South were as bad as those in the North. It was just horrendous. And then we went in as allies of the Koreans who had collaborated with the Japanese. That's why the North hates us so much. I'm not justifying it, I'm just saying that's the circumstance. And so the governments that ruled in South Korea, terrible dictatorships at various times, though there have been improvements since, but they imprisoned and beat many, many people. And so Kim Chi-ha, a poet, was imprisoned because of the poems he was writing, calling this to people's attention and supporting the resistance movement. So Muriel Rukeyser went to Seoul. She went to the prison. She stood in the rain for 3 days, demanding that Kim Chi-ha be released from prison. And eventually, he was released. He's living in Korea now, continuing to write. That's the kind of woman she was. Poem. I lived in the first century of world wars. Most mornings, I would be more or less insane. The newspapers would arrive with their careless stories. The news would pour out of various devices, interrupted by attempts to sell products to the unseen. I would call my friends on other devices. They would be more or less mad for similar reasons. Slowly, I would get to pen and paper, make my poems for others, unseen and unborn. In the day, I would be reminded of those men and women, brave, setting up signals across vast distances, considering a nameless way of living of almost unimagined values. As the lights darkened, as the lights of night brightened, we would try to imagine them, try to find each other, to construct peace, to make love, to reconcile waking with sleeping, ourselves with each other, ourselves with ourselves. We would try, by any means, to reach the limits of ourselves, to reach beyond ourselves, to let go the means, to wake. I lived in the first century of these wars. Responses. Everything is allowed. Complaints.
Have you met any of these poets?
Yes.
Did that change how you felt and understood their poetry?
Oh, I think so. Yes, I think it gave me a deeper appreciation to see where these poems came from. I would say, and sometimes the anguish out of which these poems were written. I mean, that poem that I just read by Rukeyser is a real plea. The poems of Levertov are, you know, asking for community, for asking for support, it seems to me. And they're all very different. Let's see, I'll just say the four that come to mind immediately are Daniel Berrigan. I edited an anthology of his writings called Daniel Berrigan, Poetry, Drama, Prose, so I worked with him quite closely at one point. And he's been at our house a number of times. In fact, my eight-year-old son one day at the breakfast table walked up to Dan Berrigan and said, "Well, what kind of trouble are you into now?" Well, I have to tell you one other thing about that son, because he really jammed it to us. Why are we driving this old car? How come we have this old carpet? And of course, he's completely changed now. And he tells me one day, about 10 years after that, "Dad, I haven't seen you at the Catholic Worker in a while. Are you getting middle class on me?" But it was so funny because these people were in the house, you know, when he was growing up. And of course, because they were important to me, they weren't important, right? He went to Marquette his first year, and thank God, somebody there had him reading, you know, texts in one of his courses. He calls me on the phone, very instructional in his voice. "Dad, we're reading Dorothy Day and Daniel Berrigan. They're really important." That's the magic moment, isn't it? When your children discover, you can tell them over and over, not a chance. They discover it for themselves. That's what you hope to do. Hope to set an atmosphere in which that will happen. Then Denise Levertov stayed with us a couple of times. She was a very generous person, and she came to my classes, and oh my, she was astonishing. She was a great reader, among other things. Her readings were really outstanding. Rukeyser was just amazing. When she came up from the bus, on the bus, she was a stunningly beautiful woman as a young woman. As she got older and wasn't so well, she looked a little bit frumpy, you know. She got off the bus from New York, and her skirt was kind of uneven, and you know, her hair was kind of like this. And she said, "I just saw Joyce's Ulysses, and Molly is every woman." It had made such a deep impression on her. Then she stood up at the Worcester Public Library and read. And, you know, it was like Pavarotti. I mean, she was just fantastic. I don't mean stagey at all. I just mean that the poems came through in such a wonderful way. And William Stafford was just one of the dearest people ever. And his poems, this one, he has another one. I don't have time to read, I guess, but there's a wonderful one of his. It's called At the Unnational Monument Along the Canadian Border. And he goes there to say this poem and to praise this place because there's no war memorial there. War memorials, you know, are really almost a validation of war, especially the ones from the Civil War where somebody's holding a sword or a gun or something. The Vietnam Memorial is different, of course, but conveying something of the grief and the sadness. But many war memorials just almost seem to be blessing the idea of war. Okay, anything else? One more question, please. Just stretching your arm? Well, thank you so much for...
I have a question.
Oh, yes, please. Oh, of course. There are any number of great statements. Even the UN Decade for the Culture of Peace and Nonviolence, if we don't embody it, it's not going to amount to anything. So the words are wonderful, and they're very explicit. And they were words that are, and language and listing of the essential qualities of a culture of peace, and that's good. Language will not solve it all, but language is so crucial because a lot of times, well, if I could recommend to you how dangerous language can be, there's a marvelous book by Tom Lee called Battle Babble. Battle Babble. And I really recommend it, because what Tom does, he taught at St. Anselm's, and he goes through, it's almost like a thesaurus of the terms that have been used to disguise the horror of war. Terms like collateral damage, the names of the various, new freedom or something, all these things are just to whitewash the horror that's taking place. And he's very good because he goes back and identifies the people who came up with them. Because, the people at the Pentagon are very smart, and they know if you control the discourse, that's what the Republicans have done, if you control the discourse, you've got the power to dominate. And they're very good at it. So language is crucial, I think. And the language we use, truthfulness, as Sophocles said, the first casualty of war is truth, because it's the corruption of language and describing things in a way that are inaccurate and lies, frankly. So language is important, but our actions, in order to build peace, we have to do more than read poems. And in peace studies, we need to do more than read anti-war poems. We need to try to help students develop the skills of nonviolence for resisting injustice and humiliation of themselves, for resolving and transforming conflict, and for bringing about social change without killing, without harming people. So we are called to action.